Your Steve Jones Show podcast will start shortly. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Brewers Outlet, your beverage supermarket on Reagan Street in Sunbury. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
All right, here we go. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. And today's show brought to you by Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury, the beverage supermarket. Imports, domestics, microbrews, best selection of beer anywhere. Including great specials now through Tuesday. Coors Light 24-pack, 16-ounce cans, $14.95. Svedka Seltzer Variety 12-packs, $8.99. And try a 4-pack of New Ground Hard Lattes as well. Yes. Wine coolers, water, soft drinks, snacks. They roast their peanuts fresh and hot every day. And the pickle bar, lay by the barrels and the dills. Indeed, second to none. All at Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury, the beverage supermarket. Time now for our play-by-play call of the day. Former Philly Wilson Ramos gets it done for the Mets.
One ball, two strikes. Pitch. Line to right. That's going to get down. A base hit. It bounces to the corner. All the way to the wall. Panic scores. Conforto comes home. Ramos to second. A sliding two-run double. And the Mets have a 2-0 lead as Ramos extends his hitting streak to 16 games, the longest by a Met in 10 years.
Indeed. And that's our play-by-play call of the day. All right. Let's get to our guest. We're going to talk about the Little League World Series. And this is one thing you've noticed, they throw curveballs these days. They throw curveballs, which is great. But you'll find out that there's a way of doing it that's putting less pressure on the arm. Let's welcome in our guest. Great to have you with us on the show today.
I've been fantastic, Steve. How are you?
I'm doing really well. Thanks a lot for carving out the time for us today. Appreciate it a lot. Little League World Series heads into a big weekend. And something that people do get concerned about when it comes to Little League Baseball, the number of curveballs that the youngsters over the years have thrown. But there's been a couple of changes there. What did you discover in the article that you wrote?
Yeah, so throwing a curveball in terms of the stress on your arm is no different than throwing a fastball. We often talk about kids throwing curveballs too young before their arms are fully developed, before they're ready for it, how that can cause injury, especially Tommy John injury, a tear in the ulnar collateral ligament in your elbow. There's actually no relationship between throwing a curveball specifically and that kind of injury. Throwing any kind of baseball throwing motion is an incredibly unnatural throwing motion. There's incredible stress on your arm, but a curveball doesn't make that stress any worse.
Right. Well, how important has it been? Because there have actually been some young people, and whomever's encouraging this, to get Tommy John early. I'm under the category, I don't know where you are, of, huh? what are you doing?
Yeah, the medical professionals I talked to said, especially in young players, if there's a partial tear or if there's, you know, if there's a strain of that ligament, if there's a partial tear of that ligament, rest it. You don't need to get surgery on a partial tear, according to the medical experts I talked to. I know there are folks with other opinions out there. But the biggest cure for all of that is just go play another sport. It's not even sit down and don't do anything. It's go put the baseball down and go make the basketball team. You know, and, you know, over the, you know, go put the baseball down, go make the football team, go run track and field, play volleyball, do, you know, play in the backyard with friends, make up a random game. You know, kids shouldn't be playing 12 months a year of baseball. The amount of times you pitch or throw a ball is what's going to cause injury to your arm, not the kind of pitches you throw.
In Little League baseball, especially in the Little League World Series, they have been in recent years very cognizant of pitch counts. The people you've talked to, what kind of difference has that made, if it has made a difference?
It's made a big difference, and the latest development there is it's not just strictly pitch counts anymore. It's also throw counts.
Yes.
And that's not a formal designation. But, if you pitch a certain number, if you throw a certain number of pitches, you can't go play catcher in that game.
Right.
If you threw a certain number of pitches yesterday, you might not be allowed to go play catcher today. You know, you can go play shortstop, you can go play center field, you can go play first base. You can't play catcher. Because catchers throw the ball, frankly, just as many times as pitchers do. Right. And again, it's not the kind of pitch you throw, it's not how you throw, it's the amount of times you throw. And so that's been the big development recently. The thing that medical professionals, and frankly even kind of baseball pitching advisors told me about the pitch counts is that, what's the best way to put this? People are always going to look for kind of a way around it. It's just natural human instinct. We've seen it in the Little League World Series. I'm not going to call out any of the kids, but you've seen pitchers on the mound clearly at the end of their rope, clearly fatigued, and coach comes out and says, "Can you get me one more out?" And they go, "Absolutely, I'm doing it. I'm going to get you one more out." When really the honest answer should be, "I'm not feeling it. I don't know if I can't blow it by this guy. I don't have a lot left in the tank. You know, this is not good for me." We condition pitchers to say, you know, "Leave me in, coach. I got this. Let's go." The other thing is the throw counts. Are you going to take a pitcher out and then put him at shortstop and he's just going to be ripping the ball, you know, for another three innings? Every person's body is different, of course. So the threshold of 50 pitches, you're going to see some kids in Little League World Series who are just kind of throwing. You know, everybody's great there, but there are some kids that will throw just a get-me-over fastball.
Sure.
Those kids probably shouldn't be throwing 50 pitches a game. Right. Their bodies just aren't ready for it. Even if they're allowed to, they probably shouldn't. As opposed to some of the bigger kids. I mean, we saw two studs pitch last night. When Virginia played Louisiana, Marshall Luke for Louisiana, Justin Lee for Virginia.
Right.
Big, strong kids. Great mechanics, great frames, great command. Those guys can each throw 85 pitches and then come back, you know, 3 or 4 days later, I forget what the limit is, and pick up the ball again and be healthy. So every body is different.
Yeah, there's no question. And that's important. This Little League World Series deal, though, extends. You go back to games in late June. They're playing all July. Now they get to this point, and it's August. There's been a lot of wear and tear. I know that in order to have a world tournament, you do need to play, quote, a lot of games. How do you view the Little League World Series and the length of it?
That's a great question. So the deal with a lot of these teams, so Little League on the basic level is what, at least in my neck of the woods, we call rec ball or house ball, right? It's recreational. You might have a championship in your league, but it's not like a big deal. These teams that are playing in Little League World Series, for the most part, are all-star teams.
Yes.
So you play your 10-week regular season in your Little League, and then these all-stars will play another, I think it's 5 or 6 weeks, other all-star teams, and then they'll go through their region, their state, their region, then the Little League World Series. Once you get to Williamsport, it's actually, the tournament feels like a sprint. because there's just games on constantly, but it's a 10-day tournament, it's actually spaced out pretty well.
Yes.
So once you get to Williamsport, generally you get all the rest you need, and the teams that get there are pretty deep. Playing in, it really just speaks to the depth of these teams. If you get to Williamsport, you have to be that deep, but you have to be that deep to survive playing in your region where you're going to play back-to-back days, playing in your district where you're going to play back-to-back days. Not only are you going to play back-to-back days, but some of these districts are huge. Some of these states are huge. You're going to get in the car for an hour, go, throw, win that game, come back home, sleep in your own bed, probably go to summer camp the next day, then get in the car, go back to this. You know what I mean? It's a grind. And so that's why I think you see kids relax in Williamsport in a way that it's kind of shocking. Because once they get here, everything has been made so, you know, everything is made so easy for them. They're treated like celebrities, both in terms of the attention they get, but in the resources and time that they're able to devote to just being a kid, having fun, and doing this in the most healthy way they can.
What's your view? Look, the coaches are they're volunteers.
Yeah.
They have to spend all summer doing this, which means that's a lot of time off from work. What's your level of admiration for them? And also when you get an opportunity, because they're mic'd up, so you hear what they say to the kids when they go out to talk to them around, and everything's positive all the time. So what do you think of them, the coaches?
They're incredible human beings. I think back to the coaches that I played with when I was a kid, and I probably wasn't the easiest kid to coach. And, you know, my admiration as I watch these guys do it is incredible. I mean, I was able to spend pretty much an entire afternoon with the Virginia team while I was up there. And it was in practice and in bullpens and in batting practice. You know, even when it was getting on these guys about, hey, we can't be lollygagging through this drill. We've got, you know, it was positive. It was, I know you're better than this. You know, it's really the best way to be coached, and science has proved it. The other thing, I mean, I talked to the Virginia coaches when they made this tournament, when they made it to Williamsport. They said, we have been banking vacation days for a year. we've been working overtime so we could get time off. We've been saving our comp days on the off chance that we would make it here because we thought our team was pretty good. And that speaks to, it's something that the Aspen Institute, a think tank in D.C. that studies youth sports, among other things, they put out in their report every year. I think it's like 50%, I forget the exact number, but I believe it's 50% of youth sports coaches make more than $100,000 a year.
Right.
If you are not significant means, or you don't have a job where you can take that kind of time, you're not going to be able to coach these teams. So there is a real problem about these coaches are fantastic. They're great human beings, and they know what they're talking about. But youth sports has self-selected the kind of people they want to be, it wants to be coaching. And that doesn't necessarily mean it's the best people.
Right. I believe the Virginia pitching staff threw a no-hitter against Rhode Island, right? I mean, were you there that day?
So no-hitter against Rhode Island, that was a combined no-hitter. Three pitchers, I think, one went two innings, one went two and two, one went two and a third,
right.
And then one came in for a two-out save. And then they no-hit Minnesota again 3 days later, and that was in four innings thanks to a mercy rule.
Yeah. Well, remember, it was New Hampshire that said that Rhode Island was stealing signs. An easy way to take care of that is to no-hit them.
Yes, an easy way to do that is don't let them get on base to see the sign.
This was a lot of fun. I really enjoyed it, and I really enjoyed your in-depth perspective and also what you wrote. It was really, really well done.
Thank you so much. Always great being on the show.
You bet. Thanks so much. See, it was fun talking about Little League today. Huh? And Sarah Laver is going to sing the national anthem Sunday. How about that? Singing Sunday. That's awesome. That is awesome. And she was on Mark's show today. We'll ask her later what was the greater thrill, singing at Lomity Stadium or being on Mark's show. It might be closer than you think.
Advantage push?
I don't think so. Yeah. All right, we'll come back.
Actually, she's in the building. She'll have the late-day news roundup today at 5:06.
Oh! Well, Sarah, congratulations. You're going to be awesome. I know you're sitting in the back right now typing away, but you're going to be awesome. They're lucky to have you. Not the other way around. They're lucky to have you. We'll come back with more in a moment, brought to you by Brewers Outlet here on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
Brewers Outlet, the beverage superstock superstores, ready for all of your warm weather activities. Camping, picnics, grilling, visit Brewers Outlet first. For microbrews, imports, domestic specialties, they got them. Grab some pickles at the Pickle Bar, Steve Jones' favorite place. Snacks, Brewers Outlet has that covered. Soda, sports drinks, check. Weekly specials, too. And there's lots of convenient parking. So get all the refreshments everyone will love for your next outdoor gathering at Brewers Outlet, the beverage superstock superstore, Reagan Street, Sunbury.
So what's this we're hearing about, something called the Hort Report? Is this a new feature on the Shikellamy pregame show?
That was actually when Horty was on with Kevin Herr for Shikellamy football. Those were the keys to the game before kickoff. We call that the Hort Report.
I see.
So we're trying to find. Well, that's the thing. We're trying to find a snappy name for the chief, Dave Ritchie, and we're the creative department still hasn't. They've been swinging, getting nothing but air so far. They're trying to come up with the right title. What's that? Ritchie's what? Ritchie's right.
So we've been swinging and getting nothing but air. Okay, and okay. So I just want to know, what's the difference between this and other days? No.
Hope. Got to have hope. Just remember, when you don't have hope, that means you're giving it up yourself.
Who took over you?
Sometimes is that how they, sometimes a little flash of positivity can flow. You just never know when you're going to get it.
I mean, is this what gets you through the Monday morning staff meeting?
Hope, you betcha, and coffee.
I mean, to me, the only hope I have in that thing is when you hear the words, "That should be in it." That should be it.
Yeah.
All right. So, okay.
It's cool. You don't have to wait till Wednesday hump day. By the time the meeting is over, 11 o'clock on Monday, I feel it's all downhill then the rest of the week.
Ooh, get that right. Oh, that is one brutal trip, man.
Well, when you and Horty were doing Shikellamy basketball, didn't you have like a well, no, you and Chief, I mean. You and the Chief. You and Chief. Didn't you have like a keys to the game? You didn't have a name for that? Didn't have a name for that. Always ran out of time. See, all that content you would have game after game, night after night.
It's the 5-minute open.
The 5-minute open.
Has he written tonight's open? Did he record it?
This just in from the Chief, Dave Ritchie. There is no way I could ever replace the Hort Report.
Just, Dave, just be yourself. You're more than good enough.
Yep.
More than good enough. Right? And, you know, just remember, you know, some of the issues you're going to have to deal with.
How about the Chief's smoke signals? Powered by Swedish fish.
You can't do that. No, you can't do that.
Can't do that?
No.
Nope, can't do that?
No.
We'll scrub that from the podcast.
Hey, I mean, well, okay, let's go with the Penn State Sports Network, like 60, 65 stations, Sirius XM, internet. We don't have that stuff. It's Steve and Jack talk about the game. Yeah, I know, but I mean...
Plus, we're more ready to get the weather forecast from Jack than the keys of the game. I mean, you know, we know what's the important deal
there
here.
There are certain areas of the broadcast that are sacred.
Yes.
All right. We'll let you know in a bit what kind of day it is. So we need to come up with a clever name, huh? Maybe the people can call in, preferably on Mark's show. About a clever name for the segment. Or you can just do the game.
Brilliant idea. With the sponsor to be added later.
So, is Rudy going to be making the pregame speech?
Rudy's working, so maybe he'll save that till like week 5 or something.
I think that should be the pregame speech. You too can get a job. When it comes to car buying, there's the other guy's way, and then there's the SMC way. The other guys force you into a vehicle you really don't want. The Sunbury Motors way lets you take the time you need to browse, ask questions, and take the test drive and think on it. For over 100 years, the Mertz family and all their employees have made your experience the most pleasant one you'll ever have. The other guys won't offer you the best price for your trade, no matter how much they say they will. The SMC way is their promise to provide you with the most money the market shows your vehicle is worth. The SMC way is to offer you all applicable factory rebates on new vehicles and generous discounts. Looking for a pre-owned vehicle? The SMC way checks each vehicle in a 200-mile radius to determine the lowest price, then beat it. It's the lowest price promise, just part of the SMC way. The choice is up to you. The other guy's way or the SMC way? The SMC way wins every time. Sunbury Motors Company in the North 4th Street Auto Plaza, Sunbury, and at sunburymotors.com. Selling more cars and satisfying more customers for over 100 years.
Taking your calls at 800-795-9565. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
All right, Sunbury Motors, 4th Street at Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, key routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. And today's show brought to you by Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury, the beverage supermarket. Imports, domestic, microbrews, best selection of beer anywhere, and great specials between now and Tuesday. Why don't you go ahead and ask about Coors Light 24-pack 16-ounce cans. You'll find out they're only $14.95. Svedka Seltzer, variety 12-packs, $8.99. You can also try a 4-pack of New Ground Hard Lattes. Wine coolers, water, soft drinks, snacks. They roast their peanuts fresh and hot every day in the pickle bar, led by the barrels and the dills. Indeed, second to none. All at Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury, the beverage supermarket. All right. And with that, I allow you, Sean, to introduce
the Friday 4:35 or 4:40, give or take a minute, tradition on News Radio 1070 WKOK and on the Steve Jones Show podcast. You know him, you love him, you can't live without him. Number 78 in your 1970s Enfield High School program. Number one in our hearts, it is Steve's brother, Kevin Jones.
Shama lama ding dong. What up? How's it going, guys?
only that person can make that kind of entrance.
Oh, boy, life is good. Anyway, hey, boy, the Phillies opened up a can of whoop-butt on the Red Sox, huh? How you feeling there, Steve-O?
Oh, I think that Bryce Harper's come up big. I mean, that's a big boost for Philadelphia, that big home run the other night,
well,
which
you
really
know
helped them. And their pitching was very good.
People hate the Red Sox. Because they cannot understand how the Red Sox could lose, that the Red Sox fans could possibly lose to the Phillies. And it's easy. The Phillies are a better team
In 2019,
the Phillies are a better team. The Red Sox go out and they put a whooping on Baltimore, okay? And now, okay, this is what we've been waiting for all year. You know, and now we're going to go on a run, and this is it. And then they go and lose two to Philly, And then they beat Kansas City last night in a 12-minute makeup game, and they treat it like they won the World Series. This is the most excited this place has been since, well, nobody paid to get in. So it's like they're the strangest team this year.
They're a strange team, except I will say this about the 12-minute game. There is actually something to it. It's the most exciting it's been. Because what they did was they let anybody who was 18 and younger in for free.
I know. That's what I said. Everybody got in for free. So
yeah, I'm not done yet.
And they donated the money to Dana Farber, and I know all that.
Right. 9,000 fans paid, and then 1,300
heads.
So they ended up drawing 16,000. Now, here's where the enthusiasm comes in. The Sunday at Wimbledon, you never play. But one year, they rained so much. One year, they played Sunday. And they let people in and just said, look, first come, first serve. The players told you it was the greatest day they ever had there because of the enthusiasm in the building. Remember when the Mariners, when the King Dome had the ceiling panels collapse, they went on the road the rest of the season?
Yeah.
Everywhere they went, everybody just charged a flat fee of $20 because it was extra games, and the money was donated to charity. And it was first come, first serve. And the Mariners players and the home teams all said it was the greatest deal going because people were sitting in seats they had never sat in before. So I completely believe the enthusiasm was the greatest there yesterday, because when it's happened in the past and suddenly it's not, quote, the corporate crowd sitting there, it's just somebody who really wants to be there. Like, it's like they've been aching their whole lives to be sitting there. Yeah, it's enthusiastic.
Yeah, I listen to their stations all day long, and you have to hear what people say. It's just the Red Sox problem is they keep waiting to go on a run, and then they're not going to go on a run.
They're not going on a run.
Okay, they got all excited about beating Kansas City in 12 minutes. Kansas City is a double-A baseball team.
They're not good.
Yeah, and Baltimore is a single-A baseball team.
That's right.
Anybody who's good beats the Red Sox. So.
My goodness, the Orioles have given up 259 home runs with 5 weeks to play. 5 weeks to play.
I know. It's the quality's going down. Anyway, I don't want to beat all that up. On the plus side, the first week of Hard Knocks, I didn't like. Now it's really good. You guys been watching it?
Kev, I haven't had a chance to watch anything in the last... I mean, Sean can tell you.
I don't have home box office, so I have not seen it. I'm waiting for the replays on NFL Network.
I had 13 games in 12 days. They're all night games.
I'm watching on DVR. You know, an hour
day.
To watch a TV show.
No, I haven't. Oh, I mean, the last two days I've been on the road. Sean can tell you. I haven't gotten back until 11 o'clock.
Oh, when you get a chance, watch it. It's pretty good. I mean, I work 12-hour days. I've got an hour to watch a TV show. I haven't
because I've been working 14-15 because of what the schedule's been like. So it's just been
announcing baseball games.
Well, I've got to do my shows during the day. I've got to work at Channel 3 in the morning. I've been starting work at 8 a.m. and I've been getting done at 11 at night because of the way the schedule's been the last 3-4 weeks.
Actually, Steve-O was down here with us live a couple days ago. We had our big fall sports event for our clients. So he was on the road for a little bit.
Okay.
Factor that in, too.
If you get a chance, it's really good. Gruden looks like he's fun to play for. So,
yeah.
I mean, it's pretty good. And the team is responding to him. I don't know if it will translate into anything in the season.
Let me say this about John Gruden, though. I did catch a snippet of Hard Knocks. I caught an audio clip of it. I was listening to a different podcast earlier this week after Hard Knocks was on, and they played a snippet of it, and it was Gruden was having a presser and he was talking about Antonio Brown and and Brent Musburger was there because he's this will be the second year that he's doing radio play by play for the Raiders.
And Gruden, he sounds great when he does it too.
Yeah, yeah. Brent's one of the goats for sure. He's always awesome. He made the perfect timing going to Vegas for that venture. That's for sure. Yeah. So you got Gruden answering questions, and all of a sudden he stops. He goes, "Is that Brent Musburger back there?" It's like, he was your play-by-play guy on the radio network last year. It's like, why is this surprising you? It's like, just stuff like that with Gruden playing for the camera, and it's just,
he plays it up.
Oh, he does.
He's he will go in that category as he's a player's coach, and when they win, it's great. When they lose, it's not so great, because he comes right out and says, "I don't have any rules. You're grown men," which...
Well, what? It's interesting because I talked to Bill O'Brien about that, and when Bill was here, and I said, "What's the difference for you between coaching college players and pro players?" And that's exactly what he said to Steve. And the pros, they're men. They have families, wives, kids. So they're grown men. He says, so you do have to have a different sense.
And then you get that one who's very immature,
Right, and then you get the Antonio Brown guy that that you look at and go, really? Okay, but the vast majority are responsible, family people, trying to just carve out a living, doing whatever they can to make the team, let alone being assured of being on the team. Most of them are like that.
Antonio Brown is a complicated human being. If you watch him on Hard Knocks, he's a nice guy. And then you hear the antics, the helmet, the frostbite feet, the the stuff he pulled.
The tossing furniture out a window.
That guy did this because his teammates love him. And at least at what you're watching on Hard Knocks. And you're like, wow. And then he leaves the field and turns into, I don't have words for what he turns into that I can say.
Idiot.
So it's strange. He's going to be, he is a powerful runner. They show his training regimen. Man, he is a strong runner. Yeah. I can see why he's so great, but. I don't know what's going to happen there. If he doesn't, if he doesn't get his way, he won't play. And the
in between the lines,
when
it's
flat said, it's time to basically poop or get off the plot.
Yeah, all in or all out. Well, that's the thing.
Yeah.
In between the lines and during the 60 minutes of a game, yes, he's one of the top flight wide receivers of the game. But as we've mentioned on this show, is he the hardest working? Player now in the National Football League? Nah, no way. And plus, you have another story. We talk about the feet and we talk about the helmet. And you got another story that just came out last week that there was this celebrity chef in Florida filing a lawsuit against Antonio Brown over, she claims, an unpaid bill at a restaurant where he racked up like $40,000 at a restaurant.
Wow.
Yeah, and over like 3 days.
That was at the Pro Bowl, yeah.
Yeah.
Why'd she wait till now to come up with the... I would need the money right away.
Well, it's they probably sent several invoices.
Yeah.
And finally, after a while, they said, okay, that's it. We're going to have to file a suit.
Yeah, they probably didn't want to go public, and now they feel like the only way they can do it is to go public.
Right. Yeah.
He is definitely full of himself. There's no getting around that.
There is no doubt.
And his kids are going, where's Mr. Roethlisberger? Where's Ben? And he says, I'm not on that team anymore. But where is he? I want to visit him. So,
you had all season to explain that to your kids.
Yeah. Well, that's funny because Michael O'Brien, Bill's son, who is, by the way, now going into high school. Colleen sent us a piece the other day that he's going into high school. I'm like, oh, my God. Right. He's throwing the ball in practice one day with Doc Sebastianelli.
Yep.
And so, I was just standing out to the side. They missed when I tossed one over to him. And Doc says to me, he says, so who taught you how to throw a football? He says, your dad? He goes, no, Tom Brady. I'm like,
wow.
Like, okay.
I
mean, last year he was playing
Brady.
Oh.
I know. It is amazing what he's done. It is.
Brady is just a good guy, you know. Of course, I like the little antics that he plays. He signs a contract that's not so great for him and puts his house up for sale and then says, Everything's great, man.
It's all good. I mean, he doesn't have to sign a big contract because guess what? I mean, in his household, they've got enough money in the household.
Oh, God. She makes more money he makes.
I'm sure he does. Absolutely. Oh. It's funny, though. Sometimes, sometimes you get a public persona, and sometimes people don't know sometimes the private stuff unless something gets out. And I'll give you one. Roger Clemens. Now, public persona, what, everything's gone through. He can be a little surly with the media. Well, he now does something with the Jimmy Fund, Dana-Farber Institute, pediatric cancer. And if you make a donation, he'll pitch to you at Fenway Park. And, and you can get as many hits off him as you want. But, for the donation, he'll do it.
Which he's been doing the last... like a Little League game the other day and played ball. It's kind of showed up.
Right. Well, he used to do that at Boston Children's Hospital. He'd just show up. Okay. Yep. So one day he shows up. And he goes into this room and he's got a golf shirt on, boots, jeans. And the parents are like, oh, my God. This is when he was playing, okay? Oh, my God, it's Roger Clemens, it's Roger Clemens. And the little girl who's sick in bed, who's a huge Roger Clemens fan, for whatever reason, looks at him and says, that's not Roger Clemens. It's not Roger Clemens. No, it's not. So she insists. So Roger tries to impress upon her that, no, really, I am. No, you're really not. So he leaves. He leaves, gets in his car, and it's not that far from Children's Hospital of Fenway. He gets in his car, he drives to Fenway, he puts his uniform on, he drives back, and walks into the room in his uniform, and then she believed it was Roger Clemens. Right. But to do something, it seems like a small thing, but it's a big thing.
Oh, he's incredibly generous, and he's
that's what people
good
like
to the Boston area,
right,
and he does it. Without fanfare. He doesn't need people to know he's doing it.
Exactly. But you know how it is. He probably walked back into the lobby in Children's Hospital. We got the, you've been there when Chris has been there.
Yeah.
Right? And he probably walked in the lobby and went, oh, there's Roger Clemens showing off. That's not what he was doing.
It's an incredible hospital. It's like sports museum when you walk downstairs, but
yes,
then
it's
just, it's overwhelmingly touching, an experience I'll never forget, seeing these parents with tears in their eyes, and it's not good at all, but it's a wonderful, wonderful hospital. Then the Boston sports community, as much as I don't like the Red Sox, I like the other teams. But the Red Sox are wonderful to it. The Jimmy Fund is a wonderful, wonderful. They just had the big fundraiser. The radio station raised over $3 million for it. So it's a real deal. And the Red Sox do a wonderful job with it. So.
It is the real deal. And that... And you feel like it is the Harvard Medical School, just so everyone knows. That's the association, so everyone understands that.
And if you're really sick, go to any one of the Boston hospitals, and they'll get to the bottom of it.
You feel like you're among geniuses.
Yeah.
You feel like you're among geniuses, and that's, to me, the important part.
A lot of people that have been very ill and nobody could figure out what was wrong with them, and they went to Boston, Mass General, or Sloan Kettering, and they come back with an answer, and they were right. They are very, very good at what they do, and they care about people. It's more about how they care than it is about, that they... It's fascinating how good they are.
Yeah. Well, Dr. Carlos Estrada is a genius as far as the Jones family is concerned. And then my buddy Joe Durkin. Joe worked for years with the Celtics. I think you've met Joe, haven't you? I worked for years with the Celtics. And then he got out of it, and he now works for Dana-Farber.
Okay.
And it's just incredibly rewarding for him. It's funny because I was at Fenway Park for a game a few years ago, and all of a sudden I hear, Steve. I'm like, it's Joe. It's like 35,000 people there. It's Joe Durkin, who's one of the awesome guys on the face of the earth.
Yeah.
And Joe was here last year for a game. I think he came here, the week before you came. But, yeah, Joe was here for a game last year.
He had VIP seats?
Not like you did.
I don't know if I could make that trip this year, but...
You will at some point. Maybe not this year, but next year.
Yeah, well, I'm all good now. My PSA is 3.8, so...
Right.
No prostate issue at all. That's all back
right.
to normal. So they
right.
have a urologist was like, wow. And yours was really high, and now it's normal. But that's pretty good. They think, remember how swollen my right leg was?
Oh, yeah, we know that.
Not anymore.
Right.
Yeah, they think the blood clot is gone. So, took 4 years, but oh, well.
Hey.
And the infection's gone, and I'm scheduled for surgery in a couple of weeks. So. I mean, I could be running the New York Marathon in, 2 months.
I'll be frank with you. I could attempt to run the New York Marathon, which is 26 miles, 385 yards. I can make the 385 yards. After that, now.
Who's that woman, Rosie Ruiz?
Rosie Ruiz, that's what she was. She just passed away.
Oh, really?
Yes, she just passed away.
That was one of the horrible but funniest things.
Oh, God. She entered
she
the marathon at Cleveland
line,
Circle.
Like she won, you know?
Oh, she entered the race at Cleveland Circle.
Yeah.
Right? Great. She wasn't in the best of shape, so she did look like she ran 26 miles, even though she ran three-quarters of a mile.
Didn't that happen in the Olympics, too? Another female?
Yes. It was male. Frank Shorter won the gold medal in Munich in 1972.
Yeah.
And, the author was working with Jim McKay. He was an author. And his friends with Frank Shorter.
Jim Fix?
And... No, it was not. And they come into the stadium, and this other guy's there, and the analyst, Frank, it's an imposter. Frank, it's an imposter. Frank can't hear you. Because Shorter's looking around completely confused, like,
yeah,
I swear to God, I was winning the whole time. Who is this?
You're listening to News Radio 1070 WKOK Sunbury. You can hear us anywhere in the world with the Sunbury Broadcasting Corporation app.